met you when you were still a student at KTH, which is a architectural lighting course in Stockholm. And we were doing a workshop in the sort of in a housing estate on the outskirts of Stockholm. And so Cristina was a student, and then she's gone on to have this amazing career in lighting, which she's going to tell you about.
Yeah, thank you very much for that introduction. Yeah, in fact, for the invitation today, I was hesitant on what subject to talk about. But actually, seeing the previous talks, I think it's I think it's going to be a very good flow and a very good wrap up what we're going to see. So as Sharon said, I'm Cristina Martinez. I am a senior designer in ACTLD Brussels, Belgium, and I'm also proudly the Women in Lighting Ambassador for Belgium. No, it's okay. It's given for granted. So this afternoon, I would like to walk you through what, from my experience, is like the insight of a design process within different project typologies. And
it's the bottom one to go forward.
Okay, that's the whole trick. Oh, too fast. So yeah, I do introduce a little bit who am I. I was born and raised in Venezuela. I'm a trained architect. I'm not gonna talk a lot about myself today, but from my background of architecture, that's where I decided to go into lighting design as a complement to my career, because as you may imagine, I moved to Stockholm. I followed the course at KTH. And yeah, the conditions of daylight, we can say they are very different. I understood that daytime or daylight is not always given for granted wherever you are living. So that was one of my first impressions. That was a very different setting. And then of course I got my training, and I'm gonna get a hold on to this machine. And then of course I got my training in lighting design. I was telling to other attendees that for me it was a very new subject, so everything was a discovery, from how the body works and how lighting works, the types of lighting. So it was very fruitful for me, this experience. And then at the end of my studies, the question was what was next. And that's when I decided to go to Copenhagen PLDC. So it's a big event for like Pro Light and Sound that I guess you guys are most familiar with. It's a big event, done for architectural lighting, mostly. And that's where I met the team of ACTLD back then. So we started talking about interviews, and we got very well along. And that's when I joined the team of ACTLD, ACT Lighting Design, in the long for that time. I would believe that some of you are familiar with our work, but if you're not, don't worry, because I'm going to walk you through briefly to what we do. And we are a lighting design studio based in Brussels, but we are not only lighting designers. Actually, the company is born in the entertainment industry, and we do have a lot of expertise. We do creative direction, technical direction, audio, video, special effects, water features. So our spectrum of our portfolio, it's very broad, as well as our experiences. So as we say, we don't only do projects, we don't only design a particular project, but we do design experiences. We work on the merge of our design innovation. So we try to combine all these elements into our projects. So you will see from what I'm gonna show you today and what is displaying on the video, the projects are very varied, but we were gonna go through that in the presentation. So we are based in Brussels, Belgium. The company has over 25 years experience and working in the industry. We are very proud of our team. I do believe that without a team, you might not go so far. And we do have a very experienced team that combines a lot of backgrounds, a lot of expertises. And it's highly international, and all this brings all together a very fruitful content to the table when we speak about projects all over the world, and yeah, we can proudly say that some of our projects have also have recognitions and awards. So, as I said, this afternoon I would like to talk to you about design process, and that's when I said it's kind of a nice closed up of this event, as I think we are all going through that. In order to explain what a design process is, well, I found this graph on the internet where, yeah, you mostly have a brief, you have an input, you know that you need to go through a certain period of uncertainty. It's okay to be a little bit messy, it's okay to be a little bit more organic. You research, you brainstorm, you collect information. Then you go to a second step, you refine in order to develop your ideas a little bit more. And then you start kind of passing through this hopefully more linear process and more clarity in the project, narrowing down your ideas and going into a development and hopefully to a submission and an approval. And then you're ready to go. But we know that the process most of the time does not so look so linear. So it's a little bit more organic. You go for longer periods of uncertainty and maybe some periods of clarity in between. And yeah, again, the only thing that remains constant is that you have an input, you have your brief, and you will get there. You will get at the end. You don't know when and how, but this is a little bit of more like the design process. And design process and project typologies might look like a very trivial subject to speak about, but actually, whether you are a company owner, a client, a project manager, just a supplier or a team member of a project, while you have like clear objectives and clear elements throughout the design process and the objectives of it, it will smoothen out the process. So in that sense, for the purpose of this presentation, I divided the conceptualization of this first part of the presentation into three blocks. So the design process might be defined by a project type, the methodology, and the resources. So as for the project type, you can get the context. So it's about the scale and the scope of the work, and also about the temporality of the project. As a third element, I've highlighted like the stakeholder and the time investment you want to have for this type of project. Then we have the methodology, which is about the processes and the steps you will take in order to tackle or to arrive to this project, to develop this project. And that will also define your production workflow and your deliverables. And as a third block, which is supporting the other two, I'm referring to the resources. So it's about all those elements and tools that will allow you to make and develop that idea. So I'm going to go briefly into these conceptualizations, and then I will exemplify these elements in projects. So as for the project type, I've defined, let's say, I try to define a way to narrow it down how or what elements combine a project type. So we have the context. So it refers to those like environment conditions. What if it's an interior project, it's an exterior project. What is the size of the project? What are the scope of areas and uses that you're going to apply this? And your scope of work, which all together makes your mission. In my case, or yeah, in the case of ACTLD, we have been this broad portfolio of projects. So it's sometimes very important to define if it's an architectural project, entertainment project, if it's mixed, as we always discuss that there is different workflows and different timing for this. Projects. And that leads me to tempo, which is about the temporality of the project, the timeline that is going to be giving you the rhythm where you're going to be working on a project, if it's supposed to be permanent or temporary installation, because that also narrows down like the time investment you have, and whether if it's an static project, dynamic, we can go into control systems where you need some dynamics or not, or whether if this project is supposed to remain the same over time or change in the year, in the day, in the season. And as a third element of this first part, I have the stakeholder and time investment, which it's something that I found important once I've grown in my professional experience, because not to define client types, but every client is important, but that objective, if that's defined, how who is your audience? Who are you directing your message to? It's very important to understand how you're going to approach a project. So you might have a client. You may decide that it's a co-design or collaborative project. You might team up with suppliers or other external parties. You need to understand as well the end user, because we design for clients or we design for a certain purpose, but who else is going to be living and enjoying this project? And then, of course, from more like business perspective, is the prospection. So how are you dealing with the time and resources investment in a company? So it's a long lasting relationship with a client, or a targeted collaboration that you have been aiming for a while, competitions, or just visibility for the company. In our case, project types, like they kind of split, let's say, in both entertainment and architecture, but more and more they are becoming more like an experience design, where they are both running together. So as for methodology, I've explained very briefly that it's about the phases and the processes you take, and this combines as well like the deliverables. At ACTLD, we have a six-step process, and I believe like maybe it's more familiar to architectural projects, but that we all have like a certain kind of standard stepping process. In our case, we start with the concept design, passing through where we throw our first ideas, conceptualization and schematics. Then we moved on into the development of the idea, more like into schematic design and design development, where things get a little bit more feasible and you start having more like a technical production of what you need in the project development. Sometimes these two phases, let's say, they get merged because of the pace of the project. But from my experience, it's important to have like a certain kind of stepped process, so you know that you're covering all your bases. And then on this second part, like this first part, it's more based on design phases. And then afterwards, you move into the execution, which, in of course, depending on the process, on the type of project, you get different activities, let's say. So in one sense, we can have a production where we need to take care of all the elements within, whether is it a show, it's a customization, it's operation as you know it, or if it's a construction follow-up, which is more like in a longer term, in most of the cases in architectural lighting, where we need to also program, but like focusing and all this part. That leads us to the implementation and commissioning, which is referring also to the actual on-site work for both of the cases, where you foresee that everything is as designed and planned. And as last, we have the operation phase, which is where we hand over the project and all the documentation necessary to the client to operate the project. And at last of this conceptualization, we have the resources, which are those elements that will allow you to develop and move on with your project. So I've defined it as if you have the knowledge to do the project, it's very important that in order to make the project, you need to have your know-hows and the knowledge to do so. And this is very much correlated as well to the elements that are going to be in the project. So it's creative direction, lighting design, scenography, audio, video content. So it's all the knowledge that sometimes you have in-house or you might need to outsource. And that leads me to the team configuration, which I find it's very important, because with the team configuration, you will have the right human resource support that you need, and as well the knowledge and the expertise is within. So it's whether a team that you have in-house, it's something that you need to outsource, or you do collaboratively, or you align with external parties. And then as for tools, I'm referring here tools that will allow you to develop and go forward into the project. And I'm narrowing to like the visual support, you go into pre-visualization, programming, you have the technical direction and the project management. So all this together make you the resources. In terms of the tools and the visual support, we at ACTLD, we are very supportive on the visual part and on the conceptualization to show up our ideas. And the process might vary a bit between experiential and architecture, but they most of the time go from a very simple sketch and first ideas, moving into more schematics. And sometimes we do develop 3D production as we need to visualize something or as we are creating something new. And some other more visual high-end production. And in that sense, we are, this is supposed to be a video, no problem. we have also pre-visualization and programming. So we have been moving more, especially the experiential team and the show team, we have been moving more into these kind of programs and tools that allow us to pre-visualize. It's a pity that I don't have the video, but that allows us to pre-visualize the project, and that would lead us into a fast-forward process. So you are not only visualizing in terms of an idea, you are going two steps forward and already have a job done for the job on site. You can do pre-programming from the comfort of the office, from the house, and then go on site. And as well, you can guarantee that what you're showing to the client is not only a visualization that looks pretty, but it's something that it actually works. And to summarize this, and I hope you're still with me, and as well as the ones connected at home, these concepts I will now, on the second part of the presentation, I will now exemplify and try to use this language in order to show you what I'm meaning about this design process and these blocks of project type methodology and resources that may be part of the projects. So the first project I would like to show you is one of my latest realized projects that was finished early this year, or the end of last year. It's Pavaletskaya Plaza, that's is in Moscow, Russia. The brief of this project is that we were engaged to do concept design, schematic design, and design development, and it's a retail development. But the particularity of this project is that it's an in-ground shopping mall, and that has a big plaza above. And the location is very strategic. It's next to Pavaletsky Plaza, and it's along the first ring of Moscow. So it's a place that it's getting a great affluence of people. And the brief was, of course, architectural lighting, but have the project as well as activation points for enjoying the site and the open space. Another interesting thing about this project is about the stakeholders, because this is a great example on long-lasting relationship with clients and recurrent collaborations with clients and architects. So in this first project, I'm gonna be a little bit more specific and go exemplify a little bit of the design process or like the methodology behind it. And and I hope I don't bore you with that. So we started with concept design, where we drew out our inspiration, our design principles, that then were translated into lighting principles and lighting guidelines. And then, of course, we, in this first exercise of a concept design, we define our objectives for the project, whether to attract, make the people experience the site, engage them, and make them linger. Because at the end of the day, all these four elements were making the project and had to be also a functional space where people will want to come back and refer back. And moving on into the concept development, again with some schematics and some referential images, we defined the more functional elements of the project, and then as well the more more entertaining or more activation, where the important part was to have this plaza and the nodes inside the shopping mall shifting throughout the time. So sometimes we will have a day-to-day situation, a scenario, moving into a seasonal and possibility of show and installation of festive lighting. And a little bit of like also following with our own projects, we were showing up the client how we would foresee in a very basic way on like the levels of dynamics and how this could behave over time. These principles were brought as well on the inside concepts, and you can see more schematic drawings, references, and moving on to like more development ideas, schematics, communication with the visual team or with the suppliers. And as I said before, we are at ACTLD, we are very keen or very, I must say, strong, and we focus a lot on the visualization. And this was also supposed to be a video, but no problem. But this was a perfect example where we did a great job. We didn't have enough calendar days, which sometimes that's very basic starting point for a project. But we did what was needed without going way and beyond, but was giving a point on what was needed for to be able to show the client and convey our ideas. And when I was saying about the stakeholders, it's also important to understand the audience or to who you're showing up your project and at what point of the project. So this kind of visual production was the right tool for us to communicate our conveyed concept. And once the project was approved and signed off for the concept design, we moved into schematic and design development. I must say that I'm not going to bore you long with the technical part, but this was a quick sketch that I had to do because this was the point that we were going into lockdown. And we finalized the concept design, moving into schematic, a full development of a project with a fairly new team, going home behind our screen. So it was very challenging as well, how to, yeah, the workflows, and that design process was also changed from one day to another. And so we move on with the schematics and the design development. We did the necessary calculations and moving into all related to the bill of quantities, all the materials and equipment specified, and budgets discussions with the client. And of course, all the documentation related to it in order to have a well-integrated project into the architecture. And as I said, this project we did from concept to design development, we didn't foresee the execution, but it's up and running. This was a great example of good collaboration. The client was fairly autonomous, which also helped a lot for the good execution of the project. And yeah, again, the relationship between the architects, the client, and us. And continuing a little bit on the same line of architectural lighting, moving in a completely different setting. The previous project was in Moscow. After COVID, I start having more projects locally. And this is a refurbishment of an office tower in Brussels, so the Louise. And we were engaged to do the facade lighting, for which we proposed to have a sort of media facade, but like very simplified to follow the architectural concept. And this project became fairly quickly like a bigger scope. We were also engaged to do the common spaces of the co-working. And the reason why I'm showing you this project is because of the workflow changed a lot by being close by with the client. And then also in this case, the client was the one abroad in London. And after we had the project finalized, let's say, well, there was the question, okay, but how does the light look? How the material looks? And as what it could look like a regular practice as well in architecture, where you gather your materials and you show the client. The brief was, can we make a showroom for showing the client the project, like summarized? And well, in my experience, this is not a common practice of lighting design. We do bring fixtures, we do ask the suppliers and we see them, but it's very hard to showcase lighting, especially when you cannot do it in the actual context. So This was a kind of a mini project inside the project that we worked together with the general contractor and of course with the supplier. So we put together the samples, we labeled, we show, but it was like, yeah, I'm pretty proud about it because it's a different practice, but it gives you an overview, and that was a very didactic resource and a tool to show and to discuss around. And yeah, this is a little bit what it looked, at least the part of our scope, and that might look as well as when you organize shootouts, which I'm not gonna bore you to show you some pictures of it because we will have it later. So. So yeah, that was for that, and continuing in Belgium in a completely different timeline as the previous project. What you see now is Saint-Cantenaire. This project started 15 years plus in the company with Bruno de Mester, and it's a little bit of what Cari Lisa was saying. Sometimes a project can take more than 15 years, and this is one of those where the project was done and in project in specifications 15 years ago, and they say, well, now we are ready. And what do we do now? We need to redo the project. I cannot speak from my experience because I didn't work on it, but you can imagine that inside the office was the question of, yeah, you're finally doing it. Yeah, 15 years after. And the interesting thing is to see how, yeah, the visuals, and even if when the material and the equipment changed, because there was a job to do there, the visual and the, yeah, the theatrical finish and that, envisager, the visual that was portrayed in the concept was shown later on. And as I said, I was gonna, I told you that I was gonna tell you and speak about different type of projects. So I'm now gonna jump into art installations, which you can imagine it's different setup, different timing, different scale than what I've shown you before. And the first project that I wanted to, what I would like to show you is Listen to Your Eyes. This is a very particular project because in terms of stakeholders, we were our own client. We did this project for Design September, which is an event happening in Brussels during the month of September, where showcases and encourage artists, design companies, etc. And the place where we did this, it was brewery, a new brewery where we did the lighting design, but the project was not finished. So you can see the unfinished setup of the site, and actually was an area that the client has already defined for art installation. So we said, okay, let's go for this. We were gonna do it there. And the interesting thing of this project is that was made in terms of resources and knowledge, let's say, was made with the team, was made by the team and with the skills of the team. And we also wanted to remain true to the context of the project. So the brief, internal brief was, it's a brasserie, it needs to, it's a brewery, sorry, it needs to portray this. And the setup was simple. You have two columns, you have one a simple blank space. And what we did was to make use of this can. So what we are highlighting is one can and having a setup of these two elements are more dynamic. So we were kind of playing with the contrast of a very analog, simple a can. Why would you light up a can? But yeah, and combine it with this kind of more dynamic element. So this was also an exercise for us to keep our installation low budget, because that's something that we also define as a challenge. And how you can, with not a lot in the space, not a lot, you can have a great concept and that you can convey an idea. And it was also merging these kind of two worlds that we're always dealing with, the dynamics and the analog, let's say. Another project that is a similar setting, it's Art, Concept and Technology. We were also our own client, and this was part of the celebration of our 25th anniversary. Was made by the team with the resources and of course with the support of suppliers, because we don't have all this equipment at in-house. but the interesting thing about this project is that we wanted to portray those elements, art, concept and technology that we are constantly working on. And they were defined into three installations. which okay, they were all in the same space, and then that lasted, I don't remember if it was a month. We didn't party for a month. The installation stayed there for some time because as part of an activity of the city. But the interesting thing is, like, from that and from that internal work that we did, these ideas came up, and with tweaking or adapting the setup, these ideas have come back into art installations or festivals. So it's how you also make use of your time investment and your resources to exploit them. And another well-known project of ours is Tree of Life. As you can see, it's a different setup than the ones before. It was an installation meant for Expo 2015, but it's a typical example on great collaboration with client or co-design. And it's a completely different timeline, because let's say it's an expo, so you would expect that it's a temporary project, but that because it worked, it became a landmark, and it's still there, so it became permanent. And of course, you have all these combination of expertises and elements within the project, such as lighting, water features, laser, some scenographic elements that were popping in and out. So it's a little bit of how are all these knowledge and expertise are combined. And in another scale, maybe for some of you, and we have some people from London, we did the Christmas lighting in Regent Street in 2014. One of the reasons I'm showing this project is because it was one of the first I worked as well in the company, so it's a little bit of a dearest project. And what I remember being kind of the highlights is, like, all this storytelling that we worked around. So the idea was to bring, if you read, this kind of conceptualization of the literal suspension of time, and of course this high-end Regent Street kind of enlightened Christmas installation. So in these, for the expertises, we had, of course, some lighting, we had some tinsel lighting, pixel control, we needed video projections, we did a great deal of video content production, some was made in-house and some was made outsourced. But in this case, we did all the design and the creative direction, not the installation, unfortunately. But it's one of it's one project that I like. And jumping into another setting or another project type, we do have the festivals, which if any of you have been participating on, of course, they have a very particular setting. Most of the time, it's very fast paced. It does not last for a long period of time, and it has a demanding production. The project that I'm bringing today, especially this festival, occurs in Belgium, in Bruges, and is for the Christmas season. And the particularity of it is that the company appointed makes all the installations. So it's not like there is an organizer doing a collective of art installations or artists, but you, as a company, you have to create all the storytelling behind, all the narrative, the parkour, and of course develop each of the installations in creative, technical, and production. So it's the whole process overall, and it lasts, so you spend not even a year, because we are doing it this year again, so you don't have even a year to do, because it doesn't start in January, and then you have to have this super short timeline to do all the process, plus these two crazy weeks installing. So in this case, you have a lot of challenges, such as having the team to do so, the knowledge, as I said, within the team, the resources in terms also of material. So all the equipment has to be foreseen in advance, otherwise you get into Christmas and you won't have anything to book. And of course, the context, the physical context of it, it's winter, it might rain, it might snow, This means that you also have to foresee the equipment to keep your installation safe. It's a public environment, but it's still temporary, but it needs to last for over a month and a half. So how do you deal with all those elements that imply to work in the public realm as well, and as well from a aesthetic point of view? And that leads me to shows, which is a part also of our portfolio. One of the ones I'm bringing today, it's in a Lula. I'm pretty sure that now Saudi Arabia is in the spotlight. So we have had the opportunity to work on two shows in between the end of last year, beginning of this year. And there are of course challenges on this project, such as the context, sandstorms, protected areas, and how do you combine as well all these expertise and knowledge to make this project. In this case in particular, and if I go back to our tools and our resources, this is where we actually made great use of pre-programming. So the team made mock-ups in-house, pre-program in-house, in order to save time on-site. And then I also remember the team saying, the timeline has shifted. We had sandstorms and we needed to stop for a certain period of time. Then you go back and work wherever you are, and it's remote site. So how do you cope within your design process? Yeah, you can foresee some things, but there are some others that you just need to adapt in the meantime. And another big project of ours is Les Cinéscenes. So it's very on point now that we're in Paris. So for who's not familiar with the project, Les Cinéscenes is part of is one of the shows of Puy-de-Fou. And Puy-de-Fou is a thematic park, medieval traditional thematic park, that is in the Western France. Right now, well, it's not only in France, there is also in London and Spain. And this is also a great example for us as a long relationship client, where you get the opportunity to work in different projects, and you have this kind of flow where you trust both ways. So Les Cinéscenes in itself, it's a very interesting project, as it's considered like a huge outdoor stage. You have special effects, water, of course, lighting, more theatrical lighting, and you have a big deal of actors, which actually act voluntarily every year. And this is a great thing in France. It's actually I was there for 4 months, and you will see, I'll tell you my story. So when I'm saying about great relationships with clients and opportunities that you might have, Neopter is one of them. Neopter, it's a fleet of drones now that the technology has evolved so much, might look like a trivial thing, but at the time also was developed for the project in order to put light on the sky. And that's when I say, like, maybe a project that was not looking like something, it might open the door for another opportunity. So in my case, I was by chance in another project in Puy-de-Fou, and I got into the thrown into the project to support the team as a drone developer. But my message here is to take advantage of those opportunities, even when it's not your job. Like, you always have the opportunity to do something else. This was the project that brought me into Puy-de-Fou. It's my first project at ACT, and the project was very advanced, but was in 2014 the new attraction of the park. And it was Chateau de Renaissance, and it's a good example of how architectural lighting, thematic lighting, permanent versus theme come all together. And you can see it in these kind of things, the setup of you don't have a fully show dynamic lighting, but you see these hints of the play of light and shadow, as Brani was saying. And one of the things also that was an opportunity for us in that project was the development of another product, Boogie, which as well in the market might exist a lot of candles, but in this case it's a candle made out of real wax, and you can program, you can do pixel control, and well, it's also I'm not biased at all by this project. When I burn candles over and over again to do them or drill and try something else, so this was kind of one of my also first collaborations with the company. Not from the development point of view, that you leave to the suppliers. And to close up a little bit on the project showcase, this is another project that I worked on at 2018-19. It now is finalized. It's Alcana and it's in Abu Dhabi. And what I liked about this project and why I selected it is because it was the perfect example on how we had to combine architectural lighting and a permanent show. Fortunately, the part of the show did not happen, but I will show you. So it's the moment where you need to combine the whole expertise of your team. We were engaged to do concept design and schematic. The setup is 1 kilometer and a half, 1 kilometer and 200. Length canal, and it's a more leisure and museum and aquarium setting. But the thing of this project was to have this kind of full architectural landscape setup, seamless, that could shift between an architectural to a full show, permanent show, that could support a water show happening daily or monthly. And that could change over time. And a little bit of how the setup of the architecture had to change between different scenarios. And this is what we can see today. This project as well, we did the concept and schematic, not the programming and further on, but I'm happy that it's been done. And there's a video here. There are some projects that I showed you, some other projects that are a little bit more entertainment. And just to wrap it up, as I said, the design process may vary a lot between our type of projects. The methodology that we use probably will have to adapt in between, and it's very important to count on your resources, the knowledge you have, the team configuration you need, and the tools that you have. And then for that, just to conclude, we need to remain flexible, because project changes, requirements change in the process. That means as well that we need to be able, or like we need to be open to think out of the box, do activities that we don't normally do, or just learn new processes. And then of course everything goes related to the requirements of the project, the scale of a project, if it's the temporality, if it's permanent, if it's a master planning, or if it's more architectural, or now more and more where they go into more experiential, where we combine everything. I believe that we shall remain engaged, we shall remain curious, and thank you very much. I hope you have enjoyed the presentation. And thanks for the invitation to Ayrton and Leading Light.
I think that was a great video to end on. It kind of really shows you the emotive power of light and, you know, those experiences. I've got a few questions. You've written loads of things.
I know.
Oi, oi.
I don't know.
Go easy on me.
It's a shopping list.
Shopping list for that.
I was going to ask about, some of the pieces that the company make, like the star for the Noor Festival. Mm-hmm. What happens to them afterwards? So all of that process goes into it, and this incredibly expensive item has been made. What happens to some of these pieces?
Well, it depends. So some of them, there are opportunities for, some of them just get dismantled and that's all you get. And that's a little bit of the process of the entertainment, which is a little bit, so much investment, both economically for whoever is paying and time investment in it. And then suddenly you do the show and it's done. But some others, and actually now that you bring the star, some others like are opportunities as well to become a piece by their own. So we have Tree of Life that became an icon. We have the star that actually from after that, it did not remain in the building, but it has been showcased again in another festival. And maybe some discussions on like, can we make more of them? So depends on the project and the opportunities that they lead into other applications.
And also, you mentioned you're obviously a company that works with lots of different types of technology, from sort of simulation stuff to drones, etc. Have you got a particular sort of favorite technology that's something you're interested in?
Me myself, Well, I love both Boogie and Neopter, but because of course I'm a very hands-on person. So once I arrived to the company, those were my first things to do. So I got to see them close and I love that. A particular technology, not really. I like that in the company, for example, we do have like a big workshop. So you're able to play around and just explore. And so it's more on the process for me, like that you get the opportunity to explore, have at hand, for example, that's why I also show the showroom, because it's basic, right? It's a downlight, it's a linear, but just by the fact of making the setup and building it up and think it through, and you know, you come with your drill and you do all the thing, that's what I like actually.
Okay. And so what would you, if somebody wanting to go into your sort of the job you have, what tips would you give somebody? What kind of person do they need to be, or what should they, how could they get to work on projects like you?
Well, you have to be open to shift very quickly in terms of timing, also explore other things, learn all the time. So it's mainly, that's, I think, something that drove me into the company and drives a lot of people into the company, is that fact that you are exposed to that variety of things. And if you're very architectural, you're saying, wow, I can do all these amazing things. And if it's the other way around, it's like, okay, I can learn a little bit more technical. So, or I can have like, instead of having such a short timeline and have projects that disappear, then maybe you can start going into long-lasting solutions.
So most of them are really sort of big budget projects, and I think you showed the one, like the brewery one.
Yeah.
is that your lowest sort of budget project, or
maybe? Yeah. I think for that, I don't remember right now. How I don't remember if it was like a 500 euros or something budget, or yeah, it was like, yeah.
Because realistically, I mean, you know, throughout all types of lighting, those top end budgets not always, you know, they're not available. So creativity for a small amount of, you know, money is quite often a challenge, isn't it?
Yeah, and actually that's a funny thing because, well, I mostly work on the architectural part, and sometimes you see the budget between a show and an architecture, and then you see the size of the project and you're like, can I have that budget instead? Yeah. So it's like how is valued, let's say, and you see the star and you say, but that has to be expensive, we will put all of it, but why am I you might not be able to walk on a shopping mall, but it's like, why do I need light? Well, you need light, you know. So yeah. It's like the importance of lighting, and maybe perhaps comes back to the thing that we always discuss, is like education in lighting. It's like, of course, it's easy to show and it's wow, and everyone is willing for that, and then you have the other side like, no, I don't need that. We can cut this. So yeah, it's a little bit of educating people both in what you need and what you need for entertainment and what you need for.
I thought what you were saying, it was really interesting about things trending towards experience design. So it's not just about architectural lighting, it's not just about event, which might obviously make those budgets a bit closer together, maybe, you never know. What do you think is driving that trend towards experience design and bringing those two things together? And how do you measure success in experience design in a public space or something like that?
Yeah, well, I think in my experience, you start seeing the shift of the request already. So everyone wants bigger. Everyone wants more. And people are not only thinking about the small cases scenario. It's like, okay, no, I want to be able to change. I want to be able to have today this, today that, tomorrow that. So that part of that, the need of dynamics. And that, I don't want to say globalization, but it's like all these mix of elements come together into now the projects are having a brief of I want more in a way. But at the same time, we are talking of energy saving and all these things. So we need to do all that in a very responsible way. So yeah, but that's how they start merging.
That's probably one of the only things we've not really touched on at all today. Is like, you know, how the massive challenge for everybody in all sectors of lighting is to start considering a sort of more circular economy, and you know how we specify and responsibly use light, and so that's another massive sort of challenge, isn't it, from the future?
Yeah, and I don't have the answer. No.
Do you not?
Yeah. No, but effectively.
Does anyone have any questions for Cristina? Do you?
Yeah.
I think Linnea.
Yeah, I think we do. So we would like to know a little bit more about the work you do as a local ambassador for WILL in Belgium. So we know that that can look very different in different countries and areas, but we're just curious about what you do locally, if you have anything to share.
Yeah, unfortunately, I don't have a lot to share. That's a challenge, actually, because of course in the network we support women in lighting in different levels, and I do really appreciate how other women in lighting ambassadors are being extremely active in other countries. I've encountered people in other events where I promote the project. Unfortunately, I have not taken like so much time to organize specific events. I can say as well that in the company itself, which is very easy to solve, no? But in the company itself, we are a lot of women, so that's something that I do try to promote. But that is always my, you know, New Year's resolution. I'm going to be more active.
But I think it's sort of worth pointing out that there's not an expectation for anyone that's an ambassador for the project to be doing thousands and thousands of things. In a way, sometimes it's just brilliant to have a person in a country that we can sort of ping you an email, go, hey, we've got a question about your country, or do you know someone, or so kind of, you know,
have being this person talk
being
to you,
a point in a network, or being able to particularly the kind of work you do, if somebody is interested or somebody wants to work in that field, to have someone we can say, hey, this is a person to talk to. So I don't want anyone to feel, you
know, I don't feel bad, because that's something we know how we work, and it's something that we do also more like as a point of contact, as you're saying. So yeah, we are there. If there is a need, there is a connecting point. And we recently also engaged an intern that reached out through Women in Lighting. So there are those things, and of course you can be passive or active supporter, but still I remain with my point, you should be more active.
watch this space.
I'll just negotiate my time, can I have more free time?
I think some countries, it's been different in different countries, because some countries have really struggled to sort of get people to be interested, or get them to, want to get together, or they have sort of like geographical problems because they're huge, they're China, they're Australia, or, it's really different from place to place. And also some places have a big lighting community, like the UK, and then Belgium obviously is tiny. So it's really different around the world. I can't see.
Okay, no.
Does anyone else have any questions, or are we ready to see some lights shortly?
I think what I'd like to do first, so we're going to take a quick break, or not a quick break, a little bit of a longer break, and sort of change this into more of a demo room. We're going to have Bryony come back up here and do a demo. I have another secret guest coming in, so still some more events for on the schedule for today. But before we take the break, I'd like to invite everyone to stand here in front of the screen, and I'd like to take a group picture of everyone who's here today.
Great,
if you don't
idea.
Mind.
And thank you, Cristina. That was
yeah,
brilliant.
Thank you. Thanks to you for an invitation.
Amazing career. Thank you.
Thanks.